Welcome, Laval. Luigi, emotions are running high today because we have a very special guest, a survivor from the Holocaust, and he's going to be blessing us. I feel so humble. He's going to be blessing us with his story.
And it's we might as well say it right away. It's going to be a two-part show.
Two-part episodes, yeah.
Two-part episodes. So we're filming two parts. So you'll see, I guess, part one now, and then there'll be part two coming up. So stay tuned, and I hope everyone learns from this incredible man, Ted Bolger. Ted Bolger, 92 years old, an inspiration to many people, including us here on the TV set of Laval Families. Mr. Bolger, welcome.
Thank you.
What an honor to have you here. Thank you so much for accepting to be with us and to share your story with our audience and ourselves.
For me, this is an obligation.
Truly understand that. You survived because there was an anti-Semitism upon Hitler's reign to power back in 1933. So you were in those camps that we hear about. How was it?
Well, Hitler came to power in 1933, but the Second World War started only in 1939 when he invaded Poland. The Hungarian Holocaust started later because the Hungarian government allied itself to Hitler, so they let the Jews alone. When he invaded the Soviet Union in 1941, the Hungarian government felt obligated to help, so they called up every man from 20 to 42, including the Jewish men. But by then, they didn't trust the Jews. Wouldn't give them a uniform, wouldn't give them a rifle. All they had is a yellow armband. And they were used clearing forests, repairing roads, and clearing minefields without equipment. So by the end of the war, 75% of these men were dead. Now, at the beginning, Hitler was victorious. But by the end of 1942, especially after the Stalingrad, the German army started to retreat, so the Hungarian government felt, let's get out of it. They tried to sue for peace, but the Germans found out, and they invaded Hungary. That was the last country Hitler invaded. The first thing, every Jew had to put on a yellow star. We had a curfew from 5 p.m. to 8 a.m., confiscated radios, telephones, all sorts of vehicles. We had no cars yet. And we weren't allowed to leave our hometown. That didn't last long. One Sunday morning, a Hungarian gendarme and a German soldier came, gave us a half an hour to pack whatever you can carry, and took us to a schoolyard where they confiscated all jewelries, including watches. We slept outside. The following morning, a train was waiting for us and took us to the next town. By then, they established a ghetto there. They simply pushed on the population from the worst part of the town, about 2,500 people, and they pushed in 12,500 Jews. They could do it because we had no furniture. We had some straw, we had some blankets. Now, the ghetto was fenced in, and mostly had the Hungarian gendarme patrolled it, that we shouldn't be actually. That didn't last long either. Again, Hungarian gendarme, German soldier came, and took us to a railroad siding, where a train waited for us, engine and cattle cars. But even the opening of the cattle cars were covered. They pushed in 80, 90 people, and they closed the cattle cars.
You were with your parents, right?
Pardon?
You were with your parents.
Yeah, I was still with my parents.
It was yourself, your mom, your dad, and your sister.
Yeah.
You want to show a picture? Let's show our viewers.
This is my family. My father fought in the First World War. He was wounded. He was decorated. Later, he became one of the executives of the Veterans Organization. My sister was 6 years younger than I was. My father had a pop and mom store because my mother helped him. The train trip lasted about 3 days because we didn't know exactly. It was always dark. By the way, you couldn't lie down. Either you stood or you sat in the car. Anyway, finally, it stopped. It was still at night. It was everything quiet. Then at daybreak, they opened the cattle cars, and we faced German soldiers with dogs. Los, los, which means fast, fast, get out, leave your belongings there. We are going to take it after you. What we found out later, the place where we arrived was Auschwitz. There, they separated the men from the women and children. And five abreast, we were going toward the end of the platform. But there was a small table in front of it, five, six SS officers, one of them in a white coat. And when you reached him, he looked at you and waved right or left. We had no idea what was going on. What we found out later, this was what they called selection. If you thought you are able to work, sent you on one side.
Strong enough to do something.
Yeah. Children, old people, weak-looking people, even young women with babies in their arms were sent to the other side. They were told, you are dirty, you have to take a shower. They took them into a large building. Bathhouse was on the top. Make you sure you know where you put your clothing. And then they took them into the shower room, but instead of water, gas came. I found out only after the war that because my sister was too young, he sent her to the wrong side. And my mother, who spoke fluent German, can I go with her? He said, yes. They were killed that morning and burned in the crematorium that night. My father and I were sent to the worker's side where we had to get undressed. We walk around naked. Then they shaved us from top to bottom. Toward the end of the day, we got this striped uniform. Slept again outside. And the first food we got was the following noon. They gave us a large bowl of watery vegetable soup, a bowl for six men. But they wouldn't give us a spoon because they said the Jews are not better than dogs. If you want to eat, eat like dogs. Well,
so you had to slurp the soup with the other six men?
Pardon?
You had to slurp the soup with the other six men?
Yeah. We were hungry enough. As a matter of fact, during my imprisonment, I often wished that the Germans would treat me as well as they treat their dogs, but they did not.
I was under that.
Well, I still remember a couple of days later, I told my father, they can't take anything else away from us. They took away our country because we felt we were Hungarians. Took away our home, our business, our family, the shirt of our back, and the rest of our dignity. But I was wrong. Then they took away my name. From then on, I was 87,846. That was my name.
That was tattooed on your wrist?
Pardon?
That was a tattoo that's on your wrist?
No.
No?
I never got a tattoo because I didn't stay long in Auschwitz and I didn't stay long enough in Dachau. And the tattoos had to do by hand. The number was on my jacket.
Sewn on your jacket.
Now, it's a long story because I was in five different camps and I participated and survived at that march where we started out 5,900 of us and less than 2,000 arrived to our next destination.
Which was
Dachau.
Dachau.
Dachau was one of the first concentration camp Hitler established. Everybody who he thought against his regime started with the communists, socialists, unionists, habitual criminals, Jews, gypsies, homosexuals. He didn't like homosexuals. But by the time we got to Dachau, Dachau changed. You see, during the war, every German man was in the army, navy, or in the air force. So the whole German economy was based on 3.5 million of Soviet prisoners and the prisoners of the concentration camps. So any time somebody needed workers, they simply called Dachau and Dachau issued the workers. My next camp was called Mühldorf, which was established simply to build a factory for actually, they had already jet paints in
mind.
Yeah, and rockets. Now, I called it Hitler's latest folly because this one was supposed to be the size of three football fields, seven stories high. So it would have taken years to build it. But in 1944, everybody knew Germans lost the war except Hitler and his gang. So we were there to carry the bags of cement to the machines. But if you slipped on the ramp, we weren't allowed to pull you out.
So you had to be careful.
Yeah.
Was your father with
no.
you during Auschwitz, Dachau?
No. My you see, when I was in Auschwitz, they were looking for tradesmen. So after high school, I couldn't go to university. I became an electrician. So my father said, go see what they want. So they grabbed me again, put me on a train, and took me to Warsaw, where the largest ghetto was, but by then, I don't know what you know about the uprising of the Warsaw ghetto. Mm-hmm. They started out between 350 and 400,000 Jews, and by 1943, there were only about 60,000 left, so out of desperation, there was an uprising. And the only way the Germans took that they had to blow up every building they burned down. And by the time we got there, that's the way the Warsaw Ghetto looked. It looks like Hiroshima, but no, that was the Warsaw Ghetto. Our job was to clean the bricks, pile them up, the local population came for cheap building material. Yeah. But by then the Soviet army was coming and they had to empty the camp, and chronologically, this was the first death march, which I mentioned before.
Yes.
Uh,
Your father stayed in
Auschwitz? My father stayed in Auschwitz. He became an orderly. There was a kind of a quarantine. You see, he spoke fluent German because he was in the First World War, mm-hmm. when the language was German. In this camp, we were 6.5 days, 12 hours a day. By then, they gave us a metal ball
I think I saw it on that side.
You have to edit this thing, yeah. By the way, at the end of the war, the U.S. Army blew up whatever was built. It fell back in one piece, and now it's, now it's a tourist attraction. I visited it a couple of years ago when they asked me to become a witness against one of the SS who was tried in Germany. A typical thing of too little, too late. Mm. He was 93 years old and half dead. Now, this camp had no water to wash. So we, oh, by the way, we all got,
a bowl.
It looks ordinary, but you see, there is a piece of wire there. Because if you lost the bowl, you had to wait until somebody else finished the soup, and most of the time, nothing left. Well, I have to mention also, by then, the German gave us a spoon, because they realized we can eat much faster with a spoon. The routine was, in this camp, a wake-up call at 4:15. Then they give us a half a liter, what they call coffee. Naturally, I haven't seen any coffee or beans. For lunch, we got a half a liter of soup. For supper, we got a whole liter of the same soup. Then they give us a piece of bread. At the beginning, it was a good piece of bread, but as the German supplies diminished, we ended up with 200 grams, sometimes some mouse droppings, sometimes some sawdust, but it was still bread. Once a week, they even give us a dab of margarine. Once in a while, they even give us 5 cigarettes, and there was an exchange rate, half a portion of bread, 5 cigarettes. I don't have to tell whoever gave us his bread for cigarettes is not around to tell his story.
Story, obviously.
Now, as I said, there was no water to wash.
In that camp, we
simply didn't wash. So pretty soon we were full with lice. So, and typhus. So from starvation, from overwork, from beating, even typhus.
At that point, how old are you?
20. Which was, he said there's such a thing, the right age. You see, I wasn't a child anymore, and I didn't have a family. Mm-hmm. It was only to look after me, because I felt that, let's say, together with your father, when you see your father is beaten and you can't help it, and the father sees that his son is starving and can't help it, that mm-hmm. makes it worse. This is my private opinion. By the way, the uniform I got in Auschwitz, I worked in it, I slept in it, and I was liberated in it. I think I changed my shirts maybe 3 times. Pretty soon our shoes were gone.
Pardon? That you were in? From the entire time that you were in?
Yeah.
Camp? 3 times?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. But, you see, it didn't seem to bother us. Later on, there were some experiments proving that if you are starving, your brain slows down. And that's how I feel that maybe that's how we, nothing bothered us anymore.
When no kidding.
It's an incredible story to tell.
It is.
When did you get liberated?
Well,
and at which camp? Concentration camp.
Actually, from Mühldorf, I was taken to a smaller camp. Then, one day, they called us back from work, and they took us back to Mühldorf, where a train was waiting for us. They pushed us into this train, 110 of us, because we were skeletons. This is
a barrack.
Three layers, 6-7 men on each layer, no straw, just a blanket. And for pillow, we used our board. Here is, they tried to disinfect us, but it wasn't worth anything because...
They tried with what?
Pardon?
To disinfect you, they tried with what?
Disinfect us from the lice.
But with what? What were they using on you guys?
I don't know, some sort of a...
That's a powder that
it's
the...
It's a powder.
It's a powder, okay.
That they pump through a mechanism.
Because we still kept the same clothing. So they pushed us into this train, and the train started to go out east, then it stopped. We had no idea what was that. What we found out later, you see, while we were in the camp, they always told us, whatever happens, you don't get out of here alive. And that was close to the end of the war. They wanted to keep their word. This train was supposed to go into an abandoned mine. All they have to do is blow up the entrance, an efficient, cheap way of killing 7,000 Jews. There were 7,000 workers in this camp. Officially, later I found out when I was back in Dachau, 3,000 men died during the 8 or 9 months while we were there. Now, I didn't mention, but after supper, we had always a roll call. When we had to stand there, the dead bodies were put on the front. And while we were standing there, the SS came and looked at you. If you didn't look strong enough, they simply pulled you out. There was always a truck waiting. They put them into this truck, went to a larger camp, and they killed them there. The same truck brought fresh workers.
Wow.
As I said, they couldn't reach this mine, so the train started to come back. By then, it seems the guard realized it is the end of the war. They wanted to make sure not to be prisoners of the Soviet army, because the difference was quite a bit. So we realized once the train was stopped in the middle of nowhere, but we had no more guards, so we opened the cattle cars, and we saw the first U.S. troops going by. They looked at us, but they wouldn't stop, you know. But that's the way we all looked. Full with lice, dirty, and full with boils due to vitamin deficiency. But they threw us some small cans. I remember I opened one. It was, I think, 2 or 3 crackers, a small piece of cheese, some yellow powder, burnt my tongue, I threw it out. It was to make lemonade. I even saw something which I thought it was a Band-Aid, and I found out later that would have been my first encounter to Western civilization. It was chewing gum.
Oh, wow.
But that afternoon, special troops came and took us into an abandoned Hitlerjugend camp, a kind of a campus, university campus. And they opened their dining room. And for the first time, I realized I was sitting on a chair. I had a table in the front of me. There was a plate. And they gave us supper, white bread, cream of wheat. So we wolfed it down, went to the back for a second portion. Some of us even got a third. But what they didn't realize, neither did we, it was too rich for our stomach. 300 of us died.
Oh my goodness, from eating right for one of the first time ever.
Yeah. I was in bed for over a week. But the next part, this became a DP or displaced person camp. We stayed there because they didn't know what to do with us. We were glad there was food. Sometimes even entertainers, some high class, according to some people, it was Eisenhower, but some generals came to look at us. I stayed there until September, when I doubled my weight, and that's the way I looked.
So handsome.
Now, I have to go back a little bit. Anybody who survived the camps, and most of the camps were liberated earlier. Auschwitz was liberated 27th of January. So anybody who survived, logical thing, let's go home and see who else survived. There was no transportation. Took sometimes 2, 3, 5 months to get back. When you get back finally, try to get back into your home, another family was there. You see, Hitler promised no Jew will come back, so the Hungarian government gave away our homes to people who were bombed out or something. By the way, that small town where I was born, population was 13,000. Amongst them, 1,150 Jews. 64 came back.
Wow.
Including my father, who was the oldest at age 54.
Mr. Bogler, we want to ask you this question. We would like to get you back on the show. It's fascinating. We're almost out of time. We want you to come back and do a part two.
Yes.
Part two, because
would you be willing to come back?
Yes, except we'll have to. Yeah, you see, I'm going on the march again.
Yes, after.
After the march?
Yes, when you're back.
Wow. Wow. It is only part one of the two parts. What a gift.
We'll announce it.
Yes.
We're going to do a part two. So the part two will be, you'll be able to see a part two coming up, because we believe it's just way too important that the next generation, that we don't forget what happened in the past, and that we do everything possible to avoid it in the future.